Hey guys, what's up? See, Saturday, actually I think it's Sunday morning by now. I'm actually looking at a Pioneer by Centrex integrated receiver with a cassette player. There is one main beef I have with the design of this unit, and I'll show you toward the end when we get to that point. But honestly, there is a backstory behind this. Not much of one, nothing crazy. But at the time, and I didn't realize it, at the time when I got it, I hadn't realized that this is probably the best piece of equipment that I own. About 2003-2004, I paid $1 for this at Columbus Flea Market in what I think it's Columbus, New Jersey. It's like Columbus Farmers Market, but it's got this huge outdoor flea market. And I was checking out because I thought it looked cool. Now, back in that time, I was like 13 or 14 years old. I was in the A-Trax then. Not cassettes. I got out of cassettes because I grew up with them. I always had them. And, you know, it wasn't anything special to me, so I thought. I didn't get, my interest in cassettes didn't peak back up until the last couple of years or so. But I did like this one because it had this neat looking loading system on there, which we talked about my obsession with this loading system when I showed my Marantz 5220. So that's where that got started. Anyway, I had this 8-track player in my grandma's apartment. She lived at the time, and I didn't live in Levittown. I've been out of Levittown for 3 or 4 years at that point. But my dad still lived down there in my childhood home, and my grandma still lived in the Orangewood Apartments, right on Mill Creek Parkway down there. And right next to the Orangewood section of Levittown, too. And Ralph Waldo Emerson was right there next to it, too, my elementary school, but they tore that down a few years ago. Anyway, so I used this in there because I think it was Masterwork, had a Columbia logo on there. So Masterwork AM/FM 8-track player. The radio worked on it, but the 8-track player did not. It played really, really slow. And I could never get it working right. And I had a CD player hooked up to auxiliary, which is exactly what I ended up doing with this on the auxiliary. And I actually made some cassettes with it too back in the day. I used to listen to, have some good memories of that because I used to stay up all night. And it plays pretty good. I don't have an antenna like it. There's 99.1 out of Pottsville down here. No antenna. The tuner on it's okay. It's not the worst. Like I said, I used to live in back in Levittown when I was a kid, and I'd stay at my grandma's overnight in the summer because my dad had work. So during the weekdays, I'd stay there, and I would listen to this all night. And back then, I think the Hawk was still around. It was 94.5 the Hawk before they moved to 97.5. So they used to do Triple Shot Thursday. So it was one of my best memories of this unit was, I'd say around 2003-2004, somewhere in there. It was in the summertime. It was Triple Shot Thursday. I remember I was staying up all night, and it's like at 11 something. It was almost midnight. I remember that. And they played, like I said, Triple Shot Thursday. They played 3 from Pink Floyd, and in the middle, they played a song that at that point I didn't know yet. And I ended up calling into the station the next day because I couldn't get a hold of anybody that night. And it turns out the song was Pigs, 3 Different Ones off the Animals album that I've never heard before at that time. Like I said, thanks to 94.5 The Hawk back then on this exact receiver. And 94.5 The Hawk, the transmitter was actually in Fairless Hills, which is the next town over. So it came in crystal clear with nothing. So yeah, then it went to 97.5 The Hawk. Then they took it away for good back in like 2007, I think it was. So for about a year, I had this hooked up. My grandma died, unfortunately, in 2008. So this was in her apartment for years. I was able to tune in. I had two choices. I had 102.9 MGK, which was a local station. I still play that to this day. But back then, I was bitter at 102.9 because 102.9 was still there and 94.5 The Hawk wasn't, or 97.5 The Hawk wasn't. So I tuned it to 105.7 The Hawk out of the Jersey Shore, or at the time, 107.5 Frank FM out of Reading was still there, and I was able to pick that up with it. I had to tweak around with the wire a lot in the back of it. I had a piece of speaker wire as an antenna, so the tuner is pretty decent, but I have had better. And this is made by Pioneer, so the sound quality on it is actually really good.
Pianist Will Martin here on WRTI with Where Do You Stand?
It's running a pair of Snell Acoustic Type E3 speakers right now.
The saxophones. Elvin Jones on the drums, Richard Dib.
Yeah, so there's nothing else.
No, it's Tonic Press. Rick.
This is what, 94.9 or something? Hit 94.9 a little bit.
Sorry, but first, a classic from Miles and Crew.
T-102, garbage pop stations. Y-102, right now it's a crap station too. I-105, country station. Oh, 105.9, I forgot about that one. That's a local station too. That's actually 1360 AM being rebroadcast on FM. Sounds a lot better too, obviously. This one, I'm not sure what this one is. That's actually 107.5 now, but it's not Frank FM anymore. It's some Christian station. So this is without an antenna, so I can't really bash this, the tuner in here too much. I don't like classical, usually, but this is actually pretty relaxing. All right, anyway, enough screwing around. That's an amp, I've never used it. I mean, imagine.
Rolling. 1360. Smell towns up on CBS Sports Radio, hey Cody.
Jody, I got news right from the jump.
Look at that, it's pretty close too. 105.9 and 1360 AM and FM are kind of like right lined up.
Yeah, you're not doing it. Comes to Mega Millions for Tuesday drawing. Now it's only 200 million for the cash payout rather than the 400 million that we didn't hit, but somehow I'm gonna the 200 million.
I'll settle as you settle for it. Deal?
That's funny.
You gotta be in it to win it, Jeb. Put a couple
anyway,
of
I'm done throwing it off now. It's good. I've had this lighter in here from since like 2008 too. It's completely empty now, but still keep it for sentimental reasons. Anyway, start playing a tape. The tape player always works good. I think the last time I used it, it played a little slow though. This does not have Dolby noise reduction, however, it does play Type 2 tapes. I just love the freaking loading mechanism in this. See if I can bring it down a little bit so you can see it better. Before. Does sound good though. Yeah, it plays too slow. And the tape counter doesn't look like works either. It's still at 643. Dude, I am not looking forward to changing the belts in this thing. I always like that too, the eject feature. That's so cool. Like I said, I got that thing set to flat. Like I said, the fidelity is good. Speed's too slow though. I wonder if that ain't because of the belt. I bet it is. Anyone with any kind of knowledge on these mechanisms may be able to, you know, if voice their opinion and see, but I'm pretty sure that's what it is. Sorry, I pre-recorded tape. If I remember correctly, like I said, it used to play tapes pretty well. Tape in it that I know for a fact I actually used to play back then, and this exact copy too. Hysteria. The only song on here that sucks is Pour Some Sugar on Me. Garbage song. Take that one off and you got yourself a perfect album. Go in a little bit. That loading mechanism though is freaking sick. Come on. No point in really trying to mess with it too much. I think this is a chrome tape, I think, in this one, if I remember correctly. Yeah, it is. This is actually a CRO2 tape, so I can set that to chrome and not lose fidelity if I wanted to, theoretically speaking. Although we all know that you do. Yeah, I wish I had that to a song that people could recognize, but I don't. A lost cause. So the cassette deck on it needs work, which is very unfortunate because that's going to be a royal pain in the ass, I think. I've heard these things are nightmares to work on, the ones because I have an obsession with these front loading ones because of this machine. So like I said, I've read not good things about them when they don't work, but they are neat. You can't deny they're neat to look at though. I wish I could see better in there. Let me take you off the tripod. I want to take it off the tripod anyway because I want to show the back. Like I said, I could do some upgrades on it. I'd like to put a dial light in because you can see it only lights up when you have that on. And this one over here, the tuning meter lights up when you have AM or FM on. The tuning scale's a little weird too. Yeah, no, it's just small. And you can't do a good, yeah, you can, I guess. Clear the whole dial, but the dial indicator is 100% dead on though. Well, that's definitely 99.1 FM, 100%. No ifs, ands, or buts about it. Gotta tune a little bit. There we go. Thinking it also keyed a little bit too and put it on a record mode without there being a tape in it, if I recall correctly. See. I think I used to do that too. Get a little view meter action out of it. Everybody loves view meters. It'll look cool for a second. Anyway. Trying to hit that record button at the same time is a real pain in the ass. There you go, I got the shot I wanted. They can walk around back. Yeah, so it's not very well lit back here, but. The turntable input, auxiliary input, and back about that flaw, is these garbage. These are the worst speaker connections ever. I hate them. Nothing screams like I am a budget product like having these stupid RCA jack speaker inputs. That's how I got it rigged up for now. So don't judge me too hard on that. I got I got killer speakers with banana connectors on it, hooked up to a crap connection like that. Anyway, here's the nameplate for it. If I had to take a guess, I'd say this is like early 1980s. And it's, like I said, Pioneer Centrex model number KH-787, or is it 67? I think it's 87. I don't even think it says it up here. No, it doesn't. Can't say it's not a nice looking little radio though. I'm not sure what the output is. I can't see it being any more than maybe 15 to 20 watts per channel. It does play loud though. Put you back in the tripod for a minute. Let's take a look at the inside. Music's relaxing. That's not my go-to, but I'd be lying if I told you I hated it. It'd be nice if I had a real wood case too, but it does not. I think I have had this apart before years ago. I turned it off. I think I have had it apart years ago, but not recently. It's your tuner board. I always like the way these SM tuners look on the inside. It's pretty cool. Oh, I think that, what's that? Correct me if I'm wrong, but a tube gang, I believe they call that. Like I said, I'm not an expert at all. I'm assuming this is your amp board right here, the one right underneath. I'd say it's a safe bet. I said the caps all look decent in them. It's pretty clean on the inside. That's not too hot. That's your heat sink right there. Got a pretty heavy weight on the back of the tuning knob. That's your dial light right here, probably fuse lamps in there if I was a betting man. Oh, the cassette player used to light up, look at that. I never even knew that before. But yeah, it used to at one point. Cassette deck would light up and shine a light on the tape. I wish that still worked. There's your motor for the tape player. I wonder how big of a pain in the ass that's gonna be to take apart in service. Something tells me that it's not going to be fun at all. I mean, this thing is clean though, look at it. I mean, I'd say it's definitely worthy of some TLC at the very least. Like I said, I'm not an electronics wizard by any means. In fact, I don't know my ass from a hole in the ground when it comes to the technicalities. I can look at some of the mechanical stuff that's obvious, but I mean, apart from that, there's a belt right there. I don't know if you can see it. Yeah, you can see it a little bit. That's for the tape counter. your cassette mechanism. There's a belt here, belt down here. These are for all for your pulleys and whatnot. So it looks like this whole entire mechanism can come out. Actually, it might not be as bad to service as I thought it might be. Actually, the only way to really find out is to pull the board out and see. And see what you got. Part of me thinks I tried messing with it years ago, but I don't remember. But I'd say the reason that that keeps kicking the tape off is because of the belts. You can definitely tell it's playing slow. Like I said, it always sounded really good, but it is probably from like the late 70s, early 80s, I'm thinking, roughly. All your buttons and these should play. Your stop. Pause. Just stop and eject. Alright. Oh, the other thing that I'd really like to do with this unit is it looks like I said, it's another thing that says it's not of best quality. There's this cheap board that's attached to the back of the fake wood case. It's definitely an 87. Yeah, model KH-787. Or is that a 6, dude? I can't freaking tell. So worn the hell out. I think it's an 8. Is I want to get rid of these garbage speaker connectors, but the only way I can think of to do it is to maybe mount it up here and then get a make like a plate, line it up, mount the plate up here, and put those banana plug styles in, which I have some laying around somewhere. So basically disconnect these the speaker terminal board right here and put in a real one, and go from there. I'll just solder them here, mount this plate up and cut it out on the back, and basically make a modification. So if I'm going to use this, I'm going to make it way better than that, because I don't even have any speakers that use those freaking crap RCA cords. The speaker wire on them is so thin, it's ridiculous. I said, I don't think a recap is necessary or even a service look at it. I mean, the thing is clean. You can definitely see the Pioneer in it, that's for sure. Pioneer is known for, from what I've read, it's known for being pretty decently easy to service as far as everything being isolated, you know. Look at all the boards. You can eat one board at a time if you wanted to. Probably make it a world of a lot easier. Anyway, I think that's, pretty much it, honestly.
Also available in HD and at WRTI.org.
Thing, is it worth a light upgrade, worth a speaker terminal upgrade? Maybe it's a waste of time. Regardless, I'm going to do it anyway, just for sentimental reasons, because I can't bring myself to throw this away. I had this thing more than half my life. And now hi-hats sound nice, don't they? Thank you.
keep it flat and loud. Is that? Yeah. That does sound nice. Anyway, if you guys made it this far, thank you for watching, and please let me know what you think on this one. Like I said, I didn't realize it, but at the time, this was the best receiver I owned, hands down. It's pretty basic, but you know what? Definitely, you can tell it's made by Pioneer, 100%. Like I said, the sound quality is freaking great on it. The only real issue it has is the tape deck needs new belts, and they could have used an actual real speaker connection instead of that crap RCA, you know, plugins. But they're good for line level components. That's the only thing that those things should ever be used for. Anyway, guys, peace out, and let me know what you think. Thank you for watching.